And it's interesting. I know we're going on and on.
Yeah, no.
What I did study, people always thought I studied through university that I studied music or the arts, but I actually studied recreation for people with special needs. That was and through that, I had to take a lot of communication classes. And I think as a mother, one thing I did do, and as a wife growing up, I always made sure we communicated, like when they were little. And what you just said was so important. There's a, I always say, there's such an art to and how we communicate, how we feel. Like for instance, someone hurt you, and I would teach my kids this early. Someone hurt them. Instead of saying, "You hurt me," like immediately, the receiver is going to get defensive. They're going to go, "I hurt you." They're going to. But instead, I've taught my kids to say, "I'm hurt," and no one's going to say, "You're not hurt," because it's you. Always come from you. And I've learned that. To me, that's one key communicating. That I think that, especially when you were bringing up the topic of men and not being able to express themselves, or not as much as women do, because we love to talk. We tell you everything.
I think, I mean, one of the things I do say to when I used to do therapy with women, it was about if you had a husband or son and they offend you, instead of saying, you always do this, you always do this, if you turned it around and say, when you do this, it makes me feel like this. As
Right.
men, we can process the fact that our actions have this effect on you, as opposed to I'm deliberately doing this because we'll become defensive. No, I'm not. I didn't. That's not my intention. I had no intention to do that. But when you say, when you did this, it made me feel like this. It's like, well, that's your actions. This is how I'm receiving it. Then I know
Yeah.
I'm responsible for my actions, as opposed to you accusing me of doing this deliberately. Because in general, most people don't do things deliberately, but we don't recognize how our actions affect another person. So as you said, when you own it, like, your actions affect me in this way, then
Yeah.
I have the choice now to say I need to change my actions because it's just how you're receiving it. So it's on me now to make that change. So it is this is the communication. It is that. And then I think, as I said, it's good that you're speaking about it because this is part of why I did this one thing to celebrate music, but to talk to showcase that even those who have been in the public eye have experienced certain things, and it doesn't matter where we are, we can still improve and learn with this.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, it's so true. Like, I love the platform that you have because we don't get a chance sometimes to express what we're going through. Artists, can't speak for all the artists. I'd speak for me. I don't get a chance to, but lately I have been embracing it more, like I said earlier. And yeah, artists, it's an interesting thing. We choose this, all of us. You choose the platform you're on, I choose where I am. And then this comes with it, comes along with it. Honestly, my best friend since 7th grade says I'm in the wrong business, that I need to work for the Red Cross. I'm not kidding you. And I think I'm an artist, but I think earlier in the interview I mentioned I've always had a balance, at least felt that I've had a balance. Because early on, I really felt like I had a handle my Montana life, where I would go and be this superstar in some countries. I mean, people waiting at the airport in Japan, fans, and then get on that plane and get on that bus and go to school, and just sit in the classroom, and that's where I am. That's who I am. And that other part is who I am too, but it's my work. And it helped me to get. To create a really stronger and strong balance. But I do see a lot of artists, and I remember reading something Julia Roberts, the actress, said once. She's like, if you believe all the great things that you read about yourself, then believe all the bad things. I just don't read it at all. Like some things, I've never had, I think I've always been able to balance it in a way that is healthy for me.
Mm.
But I can't imagine being an artist like a Michael Jackson or a, you know, I remember reading an article or seeing a documentary with the Beatles. And they knew when they got to the place where they looked at each other and said, you know, we're prisoners of our own music. Like the girls were screaming so loud that at one concert, you know, they were singing, I love you, yeah. And then they looked at each other and the girls were screaming so loud that they just started mouthing it. And they
Wow.
were just messing around and then after the show, they just said, they're not even hearing us anymore. You know, they get to different countries and cities and you get ushered up to the penthouse, not allowed out, stay in your room, you know, locked.
Yeah.
And of course with Michael, I remember Michael's memorial. I didn't go, I mean, I wasn't there physically, but I was watching it as we all, most of us were. And that's the first time I ever saw Stevie Wonder. He wept.
Wow.
And I said, you know, that's because I believe Michael had a huge heart. One of the nicest people you would have ever met. So I think that's because Stevie only saw his heart. And but his brother got up to speak and he told a little story about how Marlon, he said once he was in an old vintage record shop and he saw this really old man over there digging through some records, really old homeless guy looking through some records. And he walked over to the homeless guy and he whispered in the homeless guy's ear, "Hey, Mike." And Michael looked at him and said, "How'd you know it was me?" He said, "I recognize those shoes anywhere." They're all cracked up. But then he went on to say, "But that's what it was like to be Michael, that he would have to actually have physical, professional makeup artist come in to totally change his visage in order to just walk down the street and have some bit of normalcy." When you think about that, you know, can you think about the price that you pay? And I'm sitting here saying I couldn't go to soccer practice or I couldn't go, you know, track meets, but there are people like that who reach that magnitude. And it's a huge price that
But
you
in your
pay.
early days, was it like that then for you guys during We Are Family? And I'm thinking of you during the one of those songs where this peak, was it like that for you?
You know, yes, of course, more, but I'll be very honest with you. Depending on where and what territory the concerts I do now, you still get a huge amount of people that come up to you and tell you how much they love your music and blah, blah, blah. And I never take it for granted. You know, I'm like, again, like, you know, you can see I like to talk.
That's right.
I used to drive my sisters crazy because I was the one that I could start conversations, recipes and stuff. Like, we gotta go, come on. But what I have realized is that, you know, I've always looked at it as a compliment. You know, you worry when someone doesn't ask for your autograph nowadays for your selfie. But there's a crazy thing with the selfies nowadays, too, because now it's very interesting. We're living in such a world of me, 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 narcissism, me. And we are. Like, you know, I do. Sometimes someone will ask to take a picture with their phone with me. But they don't want a picture of me, they want a picture of them with me. And you know, they'll take a picture and they'll go, and they'll look at it, and then they'll go, "Oh, can we take another one?" And I'm like, "Can I see how I look at it?" You obviously don't like how you look, but I can laugh at this. But you know, I do say that, you know, we choose this, don't we? When we're artists, it comes along with it, so yeah. I never can understand artists that go, you know, "No autographs, please," or "No." Yeah, you know, you chose this, and that's the biggest compliment. And sure, in some cases, you know, you might have a flight that you have to take, and you have to say, "Oh, I gotta go," you know. But I always take the time because I think I really do sincerely think it's the biggest compliment when someone wants to give you accolades for your work that you do, or buy your music, or appreciate your music. And I remember, I think it was Carly Simon. I remember reading something she said once. She's like, "Isn't that like why we kind of worked in clubs until 2 in the morning? Somebody could hear our music, and
yeah,
now it's become this big thing, and we have a problem with it." So I think a lot of artists need to check that, you know, of why. It comes
Yeah. Yeah, but you know, because we, you know, because you did talk about how it was for Michael and stuff, and but then I'm could I look back and see, well, you guys, you know, four young women, especially having this big song, and all looking attractive, how
four young
much?
women in spandex.
Yes, as spandex as well. I mean, it must have been. And especially within the industry, who's protecting you guys and who was keeping you guys safe in you know?
That's a whole other show. And it's in my memoirs. Our mother was something else. Like, she actually was a gorgeous woman. She was a splitting image to Dorothy Dandridge, my mom. Wow. She was a shrewd businesswoman in a good way. I mean, here you got five daughters and five, because we have a fifth daughter, my fifth sister.
Sister.
My closest sister. She's a retired educator in Carol. And Dick Clark used to call Carol the closet sister, because whenever Debbie was on maternity leave, Carol would step in. Debbie was on maternity leave like six times. So Carol was always there. And if you Google us, if you look at YouTube, you'll always see, ah, there's Carol. You see lots of performances with the three of us or with Carol. And lost my train of thought there.
Yeah, no, just protecting four young women within this man's world.
yeah, you know, but we, I think our biggest protection, honestly, not to sound cliche, is God was always before us and behind us, and we were very blessed in that case. And our grandmother, our grandmother was, who's gonna mess with your grandmom sitting
yeah,
there?
Yeah, yeah,
But,
yeah.
and I know we did, like, we had such a huge genre of diverse audience that we would actually maybe for 2 months open for Rick James for the whole
Rick James.
And you want to know something? Not, he was always the utmost gentleman. Like,
wow.
He loved my grandma.
Hey guys, thanks for watching. Thanks for being part of the Halftime Chat community. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. But most importantly, why don't you consider being a member as a way of supporting the channel, but also getting a lot of videos ahead of time, a lot of behind the scenes stuff, and some exclusive content that doesn't get shared. But anyway, thanks for watching, and thanks for being part of Halftime Chat.